إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. Indeed, the most truthful of speech and the best of words are the words and the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the best guidance is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وشر الأمور محدثاتها. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وكل محدثة بدعة. Everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. And every going astray and every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْدَ. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, a year ago, we faced a worldwide pandemic, not imagining in a million years that we'd be going through what we've been going through. Something so tiny, not visible to the naked eye, from the soldiers, من جنود الله, from the soldiers of Allah. Yet it was taking down the strongest of people, taking life after life, whether they were young or old, whether they were healthy or sick, before it came to them. The thought and the hope was maybe this was the wake-up call that humanity needed to come back to their Lord, to come back to Allah, to this deen of al-Islam, to slow down, to stop only pursuing this dunya, and pursuing the akhirah, the next life in addition to it, knowing that real happiness will not come to us until both of our feet are entered into Jannah. يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّةِ ارْجِعِي إِلَىٰ رَبِّكِ رَاضِيَةً مَرْضِيَّةً فَدُخُلِي فِي عِبَادِي وَدُخُلِي جَنَّتِي. Allah says what means, and it will be said to the pious, O you, the one in complete, real satisfaction, come back to your Lord, well-pleased yourself and well-pleasing unto Him. Enter you then amongst my slaves, my honored slaves, and enter you into my paradise. So it was a hope that I had for myself, for our community, for the Muslims around the world. But still, seeing death in front of us still does not change us. We are so heedless, we're lost, we're infatuated with the material possessions of this world, as if that's the only reason we have to live. We're so hasty, still so greedy, still so discontent, never happy, never satisfied, impatient with what is good and wholesome and pure and pleasing to Allah, but constantly craving and going after what will fulfill our evil desires. While we dive headfirst into disobedience, taking shaitan, al-adu al-mubin, the avowed enemy. He's not a friend in disguise. He is the avowed enemy. Clearly and openly, he's our enemy. But we take him and his guidance, and we leave Allah off, and his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this deen. So as Ramadan approaches, and we have no guarantee that we will even live till Tuesday or Wednesday to see when it will be, I implore you and myself with some things on this day. I implore you this Ramadan to work on loving Allah by balancing fear and hope. The common thinking nowadays is we only want to hear in Allah Ghafoor Rahim, that Allah is the most forgiving and the most merciful. And the other extreme, some, they only want to talk, Wallahu Shadeedul Iqab, and Allah is the most severe in punishment. There is a balance that has to be issued within ourselves. And at the head of that balance is loving Allah. لأن حلاوة الإيمان لمن كان يحب الله ورسوله. حلاوة الإيمان, to taste that sweetness of faith. من كان الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما. The one who really tastes the sweetness of faith is the one who loves Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than anyone and anything else. Ibn al-Qayyim, he summarized this well in Madarij al-Salikin. He said, القلب في سيره إلى الله عز وجل بمنزلة الطائر فالمحبة رأسه والخوف والرجاء جناحه فمتى سلم الرأس والجناحان فالطائر جيد الطيران ومتى قطع الرأس مات الطائر ومتى فقد الجناحان فهو عردة لكل صائد وكاسر. Ibn al-Qayyim, he says what means the heart in its journey towards Allah, the exalted is like that of the bird. The head of the bird is the love that you have, the muhabba you have for Allah Azza wa Jalla, the love you have for Allah. And the wings of the bird are hope and fear. When the head is healthy and the wings are balanced, then the bird will fly well. We don't see a bird flapping one wing and being able to take off and being safe. But when the head is cut off, does the bird have life? No, it doesn't. And although you may see some people breathing, sleeping, eating, walking, toiling in the on the earth, although you may see them in that way, they're really dead if there's no muhabba for Allah in his heart. They're dead if they have no love for Allah in his heart. When the head is cut off, the bird will die. When the wings are damaged, and in this case we said it's khawf and raja, it's fear and hope. Hope for Allah's mercy, fear of his punishment. If you fear Allah so much that you don't believe in His mercy, it's like having one wing to the bird. And if you hope for Allah's mercy but you have no fear of Allah, it's again like having one wing to the bird. It will not fly. And then it's vulnerable to every hunter and predator. So I implore you this Ramadan to work on loving Allah and balancing love and fear. Balancing hope and fear. Hope for Allah's mercy and the reward of Jannah. Fear of Allah's punishment and being sent to the hellfire. I implore you this Ramadan to put your prayers to the highest priority. Some will fast and not do any prayers. And this is pointless. It is the salah that will be the first thing that we're asked about from the actions on the Day of Judgment. So you can fast and give your zakah and make hajj, but if you have not established your prayers, then this person's actions are not needed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the common thing here is for those who do pray, to safeguard your prayers and slow down with respect to them. A man came to the Prophet ﷺ, he said, عَلِّمْنِي وَأَوْجِزْ. He said, teach me, O Messenger of Allah ﷺ, but make it something that's concise. Make it brief. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said in this hadith, إِذَا قُمْتَ فِي صَلَاتِكَ فَصَلِّ صَلَاتَ مُوَدِّعٍ. He said, when you get up to pray, pray as if it's your last prayer. Every prayer you pray, pray as if you will not live to see the next one. You will not get to make sajda to Allah again. You will not get to beg Allah for forgiveness in it. You will not be able to ask for guidance in it. Pray every prayer as if it's your last prayer. Is the one who prays 4 rak'at and 3 or 4 or 5 minutes praying as if it's their last prayer. When they peck on the ground like a bird or a duck that's picking up a little crumb, this person who prays in that similar fashion, it is as if they have no prayer. Allah says, يَوْمَ يَكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السَّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ. Allah reminds us in the Quran, what means, remember the day when the shin, the actual shin or the leg of Allah will be shown bare. And they will be called to prostrate and make sajda to Allah. And they will not be able to do so. يعني the munafiqeen, the hypocrites will not be able to do this. The sajda is the closest we are to Allah. Not physically, as He is above the seven heavens, above His arsh, separate from His creation, and this does not limit Him in any way whatsoever. But the closest we are to Allah is in that position. Allah's Messenger ﷺ, he said, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدٌ. رواه مسلم. The Prophet ﷺ said, the closest a servant is to his or her Lord is when they're in that state of sajda. You claim you love Allah and you want to get Allah's mercy and forgiveness, but your sajda doesn't equal 1 second. How can this be? Thabit, he reported on the authority of Anas radiallahu anhu. He said, while leading in prayer, I do not shorten anything in the prayer. I pray as I saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam leading us in prayer. Thabit said, Anas, he used to do what I do not see you people doing. كَانَ إِذَا رَفَعَ رَأْسَهُ مِنَ الرُّكُوعِ أَنْ تَصَبَ قَائِمًا حَتَّى يَقُولَ الْقَائِلِ قَدْ نَسِي وَإِذَا رَفَعَ رَأْسَهُ مِنَ السَّجْدَةِ مَكَثَ حَتَّى يَقُولَ الْقَائِلِ قَدْ نَسِي رواه مسلم. Anas, it was reported that he used, the way he used to pray is that when he lifted his head from bowing, from making ruku', سَمِيَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَهُ, he stood up and it was so long that the people behind him would say he's forgot that he has to go into sajda. And when he was in sajda and he would sit up, bayna sajdatayn, between the two sajdas, between the two prostrations, he would pause so long that the people behind him would say he forgot he has to make another sajda. Look around you or question yourself. When you see the people praying and it's one motion down for sajda, up, they don't even let their body sit and they're going back down for that second sajda. This is the closest you are to Allah. Between the two sajdas, Rabbi khfirli, Rabbi khfirli, saying, oh my Lord, forgive me, oh my Lord, forgive me. What's the rush? Do you want Allah to rush with you and just say, you didn't give me your time, so just go to the hellfire? You don't want this for yourself. Abu Hurairah, he narrated that once the Prophet ﷺ, he entered a masjid and he saw a man praying. And the man left, when he was done with the prayer, he came, he said, irja' fasalli fa'innaka lam tusalli. Go back and pray, you have not prayed. So the man went back again and did so. He came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam again, a second time. Irja' fasalli fa'innaka lam tusalli. Go back and pray, you have not prayed. The man did it a third time till he got to the point, he said, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I'm doing what I know. So teach me how to correctly pray. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told him, when you stand for the prayer, say takbir, takbiratul ihram, Allahu Akbar, to enter the prayer. Read from the Quran what is easy for you and what you know. ثم أركع حتى تطمئن راكعا ثم أرفع حتى تعتدل قائما ثم أسجد حتى تطمئن ساجدا ثم أرفع حتى تطمئن جالسا ثم أسجد حتى تطمئن ساجدا ثم أفعل ذلك في صلاتك كلها. The rest of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, he taught him, okay, you read what is easy from the Quran, then you make ruku' until your bones are settled and your back is straight and you're looking straight down on the ground, to the ground. When your bones are settled, when you are calm and you've taken that breath, then you begin Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, three or more times, for example. Then Sami Allahu liman hamidah, you stand up until your bones have settled. Subhanallah, there are many who get up from ruku' and it's a rocking motion and they're going right down into sajda. This is against the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli," pray as you've seen me praying. Yet this isn't the way that many of us are praying. Then make sajda till your bones are settled and you're at a state of calmness and ease. And then you make the dua that you would make in sajda. Then sit up between sajda until you're in a state of calmness and ease. Say, Rabbi fidli. Take some breaths, remember your Lord, then go down for the second sajda. And he said, do this throughout all of your prayer. Do this throughout the entire prayer. So I implore you this Ramadan, establish your prayers at their fixed times and pray them with humility, with khushu', with a focus on slowing down and doing the actions of the prayer correctly. I implore you this Ramadan to work on stopping the material obsessions. Because we have just become, it's a material world. We just want and want and want and want, and we're never satisfied with what we have. Abu Hurairah, he narrates from the Prophet ﷺ, who said, يَأْتِ عَلَى النَّاسِ زَمَانٍ لَا يُبَالِ الْمَرْءُ مَا أَخَذَ مِنْهُ أَمَنِ الْحَلَالِ أَمْ مِنَ الْحَرَامِ رواه البخاري. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, what means a time will come when the people will not care how they gain their money, whether it's from haram or whether it's from halal. And if you don't think we're in that time, you know what the community of the Muslims across the world are doing in order to get another dollar, let alone 10 or 20 or 100 or whatever it may be. There's that time where we don't care where the halal or the haram is coming from, as long as it increases us in wealth. And Ibn Ka'b ibn Malik al-Ansari, radiallahu anhuma, from his father, he said that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَا لِئْبَانِ جَائِعَانِ أُرْسِلَ فِي غَنَمٍ بِأَفْسَدَ لَهَا مِنْ حِرْسِ الْمَرْءِ عَلَى الْمَالِ وَالشَّرَفِ لِدِينِهِ. This hadith that we have in the Sahih of al-Tirmidhi wa Sahihah al-Albani, Sheikh al-Albani, he authenticated this hadith. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, two wolves amongst free sheep. Sheep that are, yani, two wolves that are free amongst sheep. We know the wolves will devour the sheep. You know that from the nursery rhymes that we're all, that you may have heard when you were little. Wolves, they eat the sheep. Two wolves around sheep with nothing holding the wolves back or keeping them from getting to the sheep. They will do no more destruction to those sheep than a man's desire for wealth and honor will do to his deen. That desire for wealth and honor can destroy your deen inside and out. Just like two wolves would destroy sheep that have no barrier to protect them from those wolves. So we need to look at things and put things in perspective. Not everything is about the material possessions. When you get buried 10 feet under, nothing goes with you but the white sheets and the straps that held them closed till you got to your grave. I implore you this Ramadan to work on guarding your tongue and remembering that the tongue itself can spoil the fast even if you do not eat and drink. We had that hadith a few weeks ago when we were talking about the tongue for the whole khutbah. But as a reminder, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, فَأَخَذَ بِلِسَانِهِ وَقَالَ كُفَّ عَلَيْكَ هَذَا. The Prophet ﷺ, he grabbed his tongue and he told Mu'adh, restrain this. And Mu'adh, he questioned him, radiallahu anhu, are we going to be held accountable for what our tongue says? So the Prophet ﷺ, he told him, وَهَلْ يَكُبُّ النَّاسُ عَلَى وَجُوهِهِمْ أَوْ عَلَى مَنِخِرِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ الْأَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, what else? Is there anything that will throw people into the hellfire upon their faces or upon their noses except for the harvests of their tongues? And this hadith is in the Sunnah of al-Tirmidhi and it is sound. It is a sahih hadith. We know that Uqba ibn Amir, when he asked the Prophet ﷺ, what is success? How can I save myself? The Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَمْسِكْ عَلَيْكَ لِسَانَكَ وَلْيَسَعَكَ بَيْتُكَ وَابْكِي عَلَى خَطِيئَتِكَ. The Prophet ﷺ, he told him, he mentioned to him, you want to be saved? You want salvation? Control your tongue. Keep to your home and weep and cry over the sins you have committed. Abu Hurairah, he narrates in a narration that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كُلُّ عَمَلِ إِبْنِ آدَمْ لَهُ إِلَّا الصِّيَامِ إِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ الصِّيَامُ جُنَّةِ فَإِذَا كَانَ يَوْمَ صَوْمِ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلَا يَرْفُثْ وَلَا يَصْخَبْ فَإِنْ شاتمه أحد أو قاتله فليقل إني أمرؤ صائم or إني صائم. The Prophet ﷺ narrated that Allah in this hadith Qudsi, that Allah the Mighty and the Sublime said, every deed of the son of Adam is for himself, except for the fasting. It is for me and I will reward him for it. Fasting is a shield, a barrier, a protection from the hellfire. If any one of you is fasting, let him not utter an obscenity with his mouth, or say anything foul or bad, nor get angry, nor raise his voice in anger, nor backbite, nor slander, and the likes of these things, nor lie. And if someone comes to you and insults you and fights you, do not insult and fight them, but rather say, I am fasting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ أَلْسِنَتَهُمْ وَأَيْدِيهِمْ وَأَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah said what means on that day, the day of resurrection, when their tongues, their hands, their feet, or their legs, they will bear witness against them as to what they used to do. There's no hiding it from Allah. So the tongue, although it's a small piece of meat or flesh between the two jaws, it could destroy us or it could bring us to some success with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I implore you this Ramadan to remember that tongue. In every way, it can spoil the fasting, even if you don't take a sip of water or taste a morsel of rice or food. I implore you this Ramadan to work on humbling yourself, realizing arrogance is from the worst of sins. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Man tawada'a lillah rafa'ahu." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in this hadith in Sahih Muslim, whoever is humble before Allah, whoever humbles himself, has humility before Allah, then Allah will elevate him or her in status. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La yadkhul al-jannah man kana fi qalbihi mithqala dharratin min kibr." فقال رجل إن الرجل يحب أن يكون ثوبه حسنا ونعله حسنا قال إن الله جميل يحب الجمال الكبر بطر الحق وغمط الناس رواه مسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, he who has in his heart an ant's weight, an atom's weight, even when the ants on you, you don't feel it. An atom, they're floating in the sky. This is nothing of weight to us. Whoever has that much kibr, that much pride or arrogance in their hearts, they will not enter Jannah. So a man asked the Prophet ﷺ, a man likes to wear beautiful clothing and beautiful shoes without being extravagant, of course. The Messenger of Allah ﷺ, he said, Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. Arrogance means to ridicule and reject the truth and to despise and to look down upon the people. This is what arrogance is. So I implore you this Ramadan, work on being humble. Having humility, realizing that you have and own nothing, even though in this life, on paper, it's in your possession. It all belongs and will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I implore you this Ramadan to remember our journey here is temporary. Mujahid, he narrated that Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma said that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took a hold of my shoulder and told me, "Kun fi dunya ka annaka ghariba wa abiru sabil." Be in this life as if you're a stranger or a traveler. The stranger is always cautious of his surroundings, never certain, never secure, never safe. And the traveler knows that this is a pit stop to a final destination. So they're never in a state where they're comfortable, relaxing, knowing that they're in their place, that's their home. Because that home, inshallah, is the akhirah. And we pray to Allah that we're the inhabitants of Jannah. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he used to say, وَكَانَ ابْنُ عُمَرْ يَقُولُ إِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الصَّبَاحُ وَإِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الْمَسَاءُ وَخُذْ مِنْ صَحَّتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ وَمِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. Ibn Umar, he used to add to this and say, if you survive till the evening, don't expect to live till the morning. If you survive till the morning, do not expect to live till the evening. Take from your health for your illness. Take from your health for your sickness and illness, and take from your life for your death. Meaning, the states that we're in, never think that death may not come to you. You might be breathing well, everything's functioning, your doctor just said you're in perfect health. Don't mean you're going to live forever. Don't mean you're going to even live till the evening, or until the next morning. While you're healthy, work in the path of Allah, and stop making excuses about you having other things to do. Because we get so involved, we tie our hands up, our lives up, our money up in this dunya, and we say, oh, I'm busy. You made yourself busy in that way. Where's the work for your akhirah? Serving the religion of Allah. Do it while you're healthy and do it while you're alive before death comes to you. Success and contentment will come when the heart is given to Allah. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهِ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. The day of resurrection is a day where your wealth and your children will not benefit you. The only thing who will benefit you is the one who comes to Allah with a clean heart, clean from shirk and clean from nifaq, clean from hypocrisy. Sahl ibn Sa'd, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَوْ كَانَتِ الدُّنْيَا تَعْدِلُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ جَنَاحَ بَعُوضَهِ مَا سَقَى كَافِرًا مِنْهَا شَرْبَةَ مَاءٍ. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in this hadith in the Sunan of al-Tirmidhi, and it is authentic, he said, if the world to Allah was equal to the wing of a mosquito, I can't even see mosquitoes typically, and if you can, their wing looks thinner than a tissue paper. If this world was equal in anything of its weight to the wing of a mosquito, then Allah would have never let a kafir drink a sip of water from it. This is the mindset that we have to have with respect to this dunya. Enjoy what you can of the halal. Seek good in it. But make your focus, your priority, the akhirah. May Allah make us of those who remember Him and implement these advices. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم إذا الله يغفر لكم ذنوبكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد. My brothers and sisters in Islam, I implore you this Ramadan to work on remembering your sins. Many of us don't want to remember them. We want to just focus and highlight and list the good we do. Al-Harith ibn Suwayd radiallahu anhu, he said that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he narrated two ahadith, one from himself and one from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنْ يَرَى ذَنُوبَهُ كَأَنَّهُ فِي أَصْلِ جَبَلٍ يَخَافُ عَنْ يَقَعَ عَلَيْهِ وَأَنَّ الْفَاجِرْ يَرَى ذَنُوبُهُ كَذُبَابٍ وَقَعَ عَلَى أَنْفِهِ فَقَالَ بِهِ هَكَذَا فَطَارَ. He said, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and there's a hadith similar to this, but Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said in this narration that the believer sees his sins as if he's at the base of the mountain. The mountains are his sins, and he's afraid that those sins will fall on him and crush him, and there will be no help or way out of it. The fajr, the one who is corrupt and wicked, sees his sins as something annoying. I don't want to be reminded of them. Like a fly that falls on his nose, and he just swats at it left and right, wanting it to get away from him so that it would fly away. This is the difference of them. Just because we remember our sins does not mean we despair at the mercy of Allah. Allah says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادَ الَّذِينَ أَصْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah says what means, say, O ibadi, O my slaves who have transgressed and sinned against themselves by committing evil deeds, despair not at the mercy of Allah. Verily Allah forgives all sins. Truly He is of forgiving, most merciful. ثم قال الله وإني لغفار لمن تاب وآمن وعمل صالحا ثم اهتدى. And Allah said what means, and verily I am indeed forgiving to him who repents and believes in my oneness, not associating partners with me, and does righteous deeds and then remains constant in doing them. So I implore you and myself to remember our sins, but make them push us towards making that tawbah al-nasuha, that sincere repentance, and asking Allah for forgiveness. And lastly, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I implore you this Ramadan to work on knowing that it should, what we do in Ramadan should benefit us for the year, not just in that month and we go back to leading the misguided lives that sometimes we choose to follow. I implore you this Ramadan to work on remembering Jannah, that is the prize, making it your priority. Yes, we want a home that's comfortable and spacious in this life. Yes, we want the things of this life that might be nice or we might enjoy with our families and our friends. No problem. But keep your eye on the prize. It's that Jannah that Allah, He said in the Hadith Qudsi, أَعْدَدْتُ لِعْبَادِ الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذِنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. Keep in your mind that prize. Even if you've sinned a lot, even if you've done from the major sins over and over, as long as you regret them and you repent to Allah, not committing any shirk, affirming your tawheed, remember what Allah has in store for you. Allah said in this hadith Qudsi that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam related that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I have prepared for my righteous slaves what no eye has seen. The beauty we see in this life that makes us dream of being in this country or this city or whatever, it's a slum compared to Jannah. I have prepared for my righteous slaves what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what cannot even occur to the human heart. Jannah is on a whole different level. All of this, and still the greatest gift of having those things, those material things in Jannah, and that eternal life forever and ever, being in Jannah in paradise. Yet the greatest gift to see the face of Ar-Rahman, the face of the most merciful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as an inhabitant in Jannah, on a day where Allah will call the people of Jannah, call them with Assalamu alaykum, peace be unto you. And they will say, Allahumma anta as-salam, minka as-salam, tabarak, ya dhil jalali wal ikram. And he will say, Ayna ibadil ladina ata'uni bil ghaybi wa lam yarawni. Where are my servants who obeyed me and followed me and worshipped me even though they did not see me. وَهَذَا يَوْمُ الْمَزِيدِ This is the day of the greatest increase in Jannah. When you think you've been on cloud nine and gotten everything you wanted, and yet you get called by Allah to come and see His face that He will reveal at that time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ Allah says, and paradise will be brought forth near to the muttaqoon, those who are pious and righteous, fearing Allah and keeping their duty to Him. هَذَا مَا تُوْعَدُونَ لِكُلِّ أَوَّابٍ حَفِيظٍ It will be said, this is what you were promised. It is for those who are oft returning in tawbah and repentance to Allah, who preserve their covenant with Allah by obeying Him and following the tawheed, following Islam. مَنْ خَشِيَ الرَّحْمَانَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَجَاءَ بِقَلْبٍ مُنِيبٍ The one who feared the Most Beneficent Allah without having seen Him in this worldly life, before seeing and meeting Him in the Akhirah, and they brought a heart turned in repentance, always turning, begging, knowing that it's the mercy of Allah that will get them into Jannah. أُدْخُلُوهَا بِسَلَامٍ ذَلِكَ يَوْمُ الْخُلُودِ Enter into this Jannah peacefully and with security. This is your day of eternal life. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٍ There they will have all that they desire. And we have even more for them. The glance at the face of the Almighty, the All-Wise. So I implore myself and you, my brothers and sisters in Islam, if by Allah's mercy and permission we live to see Ramadan, which could be fasting-wise starting Tuesday or Wednesday, Qiyam starting Monday night or Tuesday night, Wallahu A'lam, we'll post those things and send out the messages. This is the time. You are alive. Your soul is not in your throat. The sun has not risen in the west. This is the time, and Ramadan is the tool, and it will only benefit you if you want to make a lasting change. So I implore myself and I implore you. From now, even if we don't get to see Ramadan, but in case we do get to live it and see it, put your heart, put your mind, put your priorities in motion so that you, we, all of us and our families, our children, can be from those who enter Jannah in peace and security to see the face of our Lord. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك أنت سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين